Hello, J Street. Dear friends, thanks for inviting me to address your distinguished conference. This is not a place for us to agree on everything. It would be strange if we actually did. However, the importance of this conference is that J Street had created an open, respectful, and welcoming forum for the exchange of ideas. It's ironic that some on both sides, Palestinians and Israelis, did not want me to be here today. Some Palestinians called to boycott this conference. Some Israelis asked other participants not to take part because I'm a speaker, because it's J Street. I'm here not because of indifference or insensitivity. I'm here because I believe we and J Street can make the difference. While we may disagree on some things, we agree on basic principles. Number one, the two-state solution on the 1967 borders is not a favor either to Palestinians or Israelis. Rather, it is a formula to achieve a just and lasting peace for us and for our future generations. Second, occupation corrupts. The real threat on Israel is the continuation of its occupation of the Palestinian people. What you see in Israel today, racism and the appetite for further land grabs have become mainstream, is a consequence of decades of occupation carried out with impunity. Third, settlements are not only obstacle to peace. Funding settlements is immoral, illegal, and most importantly, it denies the Palestinians' right to self-determination. I think we agree on this point. Without fulfilling the rights of the Palestinians, there will be no peace. I'm not here to speak about the future of Israel. Israelis can decide it. Nevertheless, it's not a secret that, as expressed by Yitzhak Rabin, without a future for Palestine, there is no future for Israel. The facts are clear. I believe that the reality we are facing today is a situation equivalent to apartheid. And I'm certain that most of you present here today don't have the stomach to remain silent while the policies of occupation, discrimination, and oppression of my people, the Palestinians, simply because we are not Jews. That is why I did not come here to lecture about figures. I'm not here to remind you that for the first time since 1948, there are more Palestinian Christians and Muslims than there are Israeli Jews within the territory of British historic mandated Palestine. You know well that if we fail to achieve the two-state solution, the Palestinian people are not going to disappear. as some in the Israeli political establishment still dream. Nor there will be any Palestinian that will give up his right and accept permanent subjugation as this Trump administration wants. They cut the aid of hospitals in East Jerusalem. Augusta Victoria is the only cancer center for the Palestinian people. It's about to close. They cut the aid to St. John's Hospital, operating in Jerusalem, serving Palestinian people for 141 years. They defunded UNRWA, United Nations Relief and Work Agency. They stopped the work of USAID, infrastructure projects throughout the Palestinian territories. They closed the American consulate in East Jerusalem, a consulate that did a brilliant job in creating and improving and upgrading Palestinian-American relations since 1844, 475 years. And they closed the PLO mission in Washington. They said settlements are legal. And they even omitted the term occupation from their dictionaries. And they took out from the map of the State Department the term Palestinian territories. They wanted me to come on my knees. I will not do that. We will not do that. We will not do that. And at the same time, we will not give up on making real, genuine, lasting, comprehensive peace between Palestinians and Israelis. No one. No one stands to gain more by achieving a peace agreement more than Palestinians, and no one stands to lose more in the absence of peace more than Palestinians. And we are committed to the two-state solution. Not because the term is nice, because this is the only option. Live and let live. We are here to talk about peace. We mean meaningful, real peace. Not the empty words we hear from the Trump's peace team. Peace is an end that must be rooted in justice. We certainly cannot talk about peace without acknowledging the inalienable rights of the Palestinian people. As Palestinians, we clearly defined our national interests back in 1988, when, in a painful, historic decision, we recognized the state of Israel, right to live in peace and security on the 1967 borders, and fully endorsed the international formula of a two-state solution. While we still support this formula, it's now opposed every day in word and deed by the Israeli government and by the U.S. peace team and by others. The two-state solution is a well-defined formula and requires the end of the Israeli occupation that began in 1967. It mandates the creation of a sovereign, independent state of Palestine on the 1967 borders with East Jerusalem, its capital. It requires a just, negotiated solution to the refugee issue based on the United Nations Resolution 194 as specified in the Arab Peace Initiative. There can be no two-state solution with annexation of East Jerusalem, nor with annexation of the Jordan Valley. The only two-state solution formula that works is the one where the rights of everyone, Israelis and Palestinians, are respected and dealt with under principle of equality. In this context of negotiations, there are formulas that can be found that will respect the interests and rights of all parties. This includes Jerusalem. Is Jerusalem the capital of Palestine? Was Jerusalem the capital of Israel? But then it can be an open city the day after peace. I heard many people questioning the possibility of the two-state solution. I heard many people questioning the possibility whether we can achieve peace on core issues, Jerusalem border, settlement, refugees, security. It is all doable. It's doable. And if not this year, in 50 years, the only solution will be the state of Palestine with East Jerusalem's capital to live side by side in peace and security with the state of Israel. The difference? How many lives will be lost till we leave these people in this administration of the United States and the Netanyahu government experiment with the lives of our children and grandchildren? I personally don't see an alternative to a two-state solution. Yet, I'm not blind to the realities on the ground. I would love to tell you that the two-state solution will always be the option. Yet, many see the realities on the ground and that every day the prospects of the two-state solution slip further away. Israeli settlers in the West Bank have tripled since the beginning of the peace process. The infrastructure that has been built for them aims to make the process of occupation and settlements irreversible. Now, we hear calls for further annexation of the Jordan Valley and elsewhere, all to prevent the establishment of a Palestinian state. This will not happen. A Palestinian state will be created and will live in peace side by side the state of Israel on the 1967 borders. I do not think that the process is irreversible or unstoppable. It can be reserved, and it must be stopped. Ladies and gentlemen, it's up to us. It's not about being pessimists or optimists. Yesterday is gone. We cannot do anything about it. We can write about it in the history departments for universities. Tomorrow is what we decide. And as Palestinians, we want to live and let live Israel next to the state of Palestine, living side by side in peace and security on the 1967 borders. This is the only way for a future of Palestinians and Israelis. The occupation is not going to end out of goodwill and best wishes. It needs more than that. Here in the U.S., there are several organizations that participate in funding settlements. If you want the two-state solution, this has to stop. The U.S. government is currently putting tremendous pressure on the U.N. not to publish the database of international companies operating in Israeli settlements. Israeli settlement products are the sweat and blood of the Palestinian people. It's really immoral. It's really immoral to deprive Palestinians of their natural resources, to defund them, and then go to Manama and call the conference prosperity for the Palestinians. Netanyahu and the U.S. administration peace team have defined being pro-Israel as being pro-occupation. There's a big difference between pro-Israel or being pro-Israeli occupation. As a matter of fact, being pro-Israeli occupation is being against peace and being against Israel, against Palestine, against democracy, against human rights, against everything we stand to achieve. Ladies and gentlemen, we don't have a partner in the U.S. administration. That's very unfortunate. We have nothing against the U.S. On the contrary, we have always had the best relations since the peace process began with the United States, various administrations. We may differ. I'm not denying that they were pro-Israel, but they were consistent standing tall for the two-state solution. This administration wants to undermine the two-state solution. This administration is telling us either you accept and come to your knees, or you're going to suffer more and more and more. All right. We have not developed the techniques to stand guards on people's lips, especially president's lips. We have not developed the techniques to kill ideas with bullets. Those who want to defeat terrorism in the region must understand that this is a must. Terrorism and extremism must be defeated in my region. It needs two elements. One is peace between Palestinians and Israelis. And here we don't have to reinvent the wheel or eat the apple from the start. It's two states on 1967 borders. The second is democracy in the Arab world. And anyone who says Arabs are not ready for democracy is a racist. To defeat terrorism, we have to have democracy, human rights, women's rights, accountability, transparency, and the rule of law. The absence of these elements in any society is the reason terrorism and extremism are created and flourishing. Democracy is a must. The closure of the consulate in Jerusalem showed the ideological synergy between the settlers and the Israeli government and the U.S. administration peace team. Ambassador Friedman referred to you in J Street, I quote, as Kabuz, self-hating Jews. If you are Kabuz and self-hating Jews, how does he look at me? What am I? And then when he was asked in Congress and the Senate confirmation about annexation and whether he would support it or not, he said, no, I will not support annexation. And he was cutting the ribbon in the Golan Heights, announcing its annexation, and he supported the annexation of the Jordan Valley. This is part of a difficult moment for all of us. For all of us who struggle for peace and human rights. And the forces against us are huge. The world is changing around us. Religious extremists, such as the white supremacist, right-wing populists, have taken a prominent space in international politics. They want to undermine international law. They go against international consensus, and it tests the role of the United Nations. This has been the agenda of this U.S. peace team, that of Benjamin Netanyahu and others. With those extremist views, we have also seen a rise in anti-Semitism. In the new definition of anti-Semitism, let me be very clear. Anti-Semitism is evil. Anti-occupation is noble. And those who are trying to mix between the two are determined to defeat us. Because I could care less if someone's pro-Palestinian or pro-Israel. My world is divided between those who are pro-peace and life and those who are against peace and ally with death. That is the truth. Anti-Semitism is evil, shameful, and unacceptable wherever it's found. Using this term to refer to those who oppose the Israeli occupation is an ugly distortion of reality, because being anti-occupation, as I said, is noble. Referring to those of you here and who call for an independent Palestinian state to live side by side the state of Israel on the 67 borders as self-hating Jews is despicable. We should fight all those attempts As today, several presidential candidates, I heard them. I was so encouraged, and I'm sure I'm going to hear Mr. Bennett and Senator Sanders after me. Yes, it's time to stand tall. It's time to stand tall. We should start telling people what they should hear, not what they like to hear. Judaism is one of God's great religions, like Islam and Christianity. Judaism, to us, as Palestinian Christians and Muslims, was never a threat, will never be a threat. My conflict with Israel, I want Mr. Friedman to listen to this. My conflict with Israel is not over something written in their holy book or my holy book. My conflict is a political one, territorial one, national one, and it's doable, solvable through negotiations. The God of the Jews and the Muslims and Christians is not a God that advocates conflicts and bloodshed and hatred and racism and apartheid. That's the truth. And we have many in our region who go to the places of worship not to worship God, but to use God. And using God in our region means bringing out thugs and criminals and murderers, regardless of their names, religion, or anything. Those people who take innocent people's life just simply because they don't follow us. Those are criminals and thugs. That's what ISIS is all about. I hear some Muslim intellectuals refer to them as extremist Muslims. These are thugs and criminals and murderers. And we should stand tall to find all extremists. Because when I say the real threat on Israel is Israel's occupation, I say the real threat on Arabs are Arabs. 80% of our population are less than 30 years of age. 58% of them are less than 20 years of age. This is the time to revisit our educational structure, economic, jobs, freedoms, women's rights, human rights. My mother happens to be a woman. I have twin daughters who are so professional. One is an eye surgeon and the second one is a university professor. I will not allow any forces to subjugate them to rules alien to religion, social factors, advancement, simply. Simply because they want to bring the destruction of normal life. 2 weeks ago, President Mahmoud Abbas announced and called upon Palestinian peoples to go to elections. We will have elections. Yes, we will have elections, and we're doing everything humanly possible in order to have presidential and legislative elections that all Palestinian political parties and all Palestinians who don't belong to political parties, as I heard the young youth today speaking in your conference. Everybody has the right to take part in these elections. And yes, also they have the right not to participate in these elections. But nobody has the right to veto this election. With Hamas, we differ, and we differ a great deal. But they have to understand that when we differ, it's ballots and not bullets. It's ballots and not bullets. And now that's the real challenge. We need your help. Elections must take place in the West Bank, Gaza, and East Jerusalem. With East Jerusalem, we have arrangements that we did the elections in accordance with in 1996, 2005, 2006. We don't see any reason why the Israeli government should stop us. If they want to stop elections in East Jerusalem in accordance with the signed arrangements, that means they don't want democracy, they don't want this leadership. They want another leadership. They don't want a leadership led by Mahmoud Abbas and us who want to negotiate and reach a solution with nonviolence and through negotiations, peacefully. Just one question I leave it to you. if they don't want a Palestinian leadership that believes in two states and peace negotiations void of violence? What do they want? Do they want those who sent suicide bombers? I want to finish by saying, a few weeks ago you celebrated Rosh Hashanah, which represents a new beginning. In a few weeks, we will be celebrating Christmas in Bethlehem, which represents the birth of hope for many. We have no right to give up. We have no right to give up. It's not personal. It's not you thinking whether it's doable or not doable. I'm not that intelligent to be a pessimist. But I know that together, if we don't give up and we stand tall to determine our future, we will succeed. I believe we together can make it. Israelis and Palestinians can make it. And through this podium, I would address the Palestinian people. Don't despair. You're not alone. Look at these people. Look at the international community as a whole, in the European Union, the African Union, non-aligned movement, Islamic countries, Arab countries, Latin America, and the Caribbean. Everyone on earth, except for the Trump administration and the island of Nauru. With all due respect. The occupation will end. We will have an independent Palestinian state with East Jerusalem as capital, to live side by side in peace and security with the State of Israel on the 1967 borders. This is not an injection of hope. This is not optimism. This is the most needed thing for Palestinians and Israelis. There will be no future for us without the two-state solution. We know the formula. We know it's achievable. Let's keep working for that shared goal. Let's not give up. Let's not give those elements in both sides who want to undermine the future, peaceful future. We're not great, and we don't want to be great. Peace for us and the Israelis is about being normal. Help us. Stay the course with us. Stand tall with us. Don't give up. And we together shall make it. Thank you very much.